Non-stop action. Soft-baited poker.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, boy.
That is a bulldog.
So it's the Kiwi summer, and while most people are heading up this way, I'm loading up to leave the Bay of Islands.
I leaned on the truck.
Okay, so I busted my sunnies. That's not ideal, but it's going to take more than that to dampen my enthusiasm, because we are on a mission to my favourite place in all of New Zealand. In fact, it's probably my favourite place in the world. We are off to Fiordland. It's my third trip down there, but it's going to be the first time sure my son has had the opportunity to go fishing and diving in the South Island, full stop. For this trip, Shaw wants to catch a harpooker on a soft bait, or a groper, as they call them down there. And me, well, I wouldn't mind catching a groper on fly, but mostly, I'm just keen to show Shaw everything above and below the water and eat seafood. Scallops, parwa, crayfish, and kinna. For us, it will be seafood every day.
Flight attendants must now be seated for landing.
Our flights get us as far as Queenstown, and we take off from Te Anau on the chopper. So from here we'll drive, so we picked up the Fortuna, and then before we make our way to Te Anau, I stop in and say g'day to the guys at Hunting and Fishing, just to get a few pointers on what's going on. And honestly, I tried not to buy anything, but between the sales guys and Shaw, who's a bad influence, we've bought some extra gear, and we've got our sandfly nets, so it was probably a good thing we stopped. This is where I'll introduce our mates. We've got my mate Rob and his son Jude, the two old boys and the two young bucks, a father's and son's trip, and we're heading off into what I truly believe is the ultimate outdoors man's paradise. There's honestly no better way to travel and take in this incredible landscape than in a chopper. And while it's the middle of summer, there is a howling cold southerly wind and rain to greet us. We've touched down on the beach, and the group that has been on the boat for the last week or so has told us the fishing's been really slow, and they didn't catch a single groper in an entire week of fishing. But as soon as we get onto the boat, the boys have rigged up their soft baiting gear, and they're having a fish while us mugginses load all the gear. And we're still on the mooring, and not surprisingly, they're catching some blue cod. And then Jude has gone and hooked something a little bit bigger.
Hooker!
That was your first drop for you, right?
Second, yeah. Second.
The boys.
The boys.
Yeah, the boys.
Non-stop action.
We've not even left the anchorage yet. Boys have been slaying up the blue cods. Look at that soft-baited pooker off the mooring.
Welcome to Fiordland.
So our first groper is while we're still sitting on the mooring. The helicopter's barely left. What a start. And this is the one thing Shaw wanted to do on this trip, was catch a groper on a soft bait. So now, he's super keen to get one of these. So as we head up to the top of one of the sounds, which the last time I was here is where we found the pooker, was right up the end of the sounds. Shaw's flicking around his soft bait for not long at all, really. And now he's hooked into something decent.
What have you got yourself on there?
Hopefully a pooker. Be the goal. Be mean if I can land it, whatever it is.
I reckon it's a real nice pooker. Like a hot one to here.
Is that a gap?
Oh, don't worry, I'll get a gift, mate.
Oh yeah, it's a pooker.
Oh yeah.
Nicely done. Well,
there you go. What did you want, a pooker on a soft
pooker
bait?
Pooker on soft bait.
Yeah.
Yeah, boy.
Yeah, matey. Woo!
Pooka on
soft bait.
There you go, mate. That's what you wanted.
That's what I wanted, all right.
There you go. Yeah. $1
Yeah. Exactly. Well done. The two young fellas, eh? Caught their bloody pookas on soft bait.
That is so cool.
Fingers are frozen. I can't turn the camera off. We're in Fiordland and we're soft baiting.
Some bit of action on that rock, though.
Beautiful, isn't it?
Third pooka.
Mmm.
Oh, yeah.
Last week, this boat didn't catch a single groper. We've nailed three straight away. You know, it's the same boat in the same areas. Only difference is we're fishing with no bait. On this trip, we're fishing exclusively with lures. I even get the fly rod out to try my luck catching a groper on fly. But this blue cod was a nice little consolation prize. And when you're talking about cooked fish, blue cod has to be the very best. So whenever I'm down south here, I eat blue cod every chance I get. And every time I come down here, I have to reacquaint myself with how to fillet these. And there's a clever little way to do it that leaves all the bone on the skin. And we've got a full demo of how to do this on ultimatefishing.tv. Just look up how to fillet blue cod or check out the cooking playlist on ultimatefishing.tv. Another favorite cut for me is the wings on these groper.
Yes, boy, yes, boy.
And while I'm cleaning up these fish for dinner, Shaw has already broken our lures only rule and put some of the fish scraps on a hook and he's lobbed them out. And there must have been something lurking down there eating all the fish scraps because he's hooked up straight away.
Yeah, boy!
You got owned! Did it just snap that, eh? That is great.
Yeah, I think so. Oh, I don't know, I was putting more tension than that before. Yeah, that thing was massive!
You would have got it back if you let it run a bit more.
Because this is a liveaboard charter, we're staying on the boat, we've got a galley right next to our source of fish that we catch. So we can catch, fillet, dust and flour, and cook them straight away. Just on the hot plate with some butter, and we've got pooka wings that I can just put in the oven with some salt and slices of onion. Nothing fancy, but it's the freshness and I think this environment and lads on a boat that combine to make a feed like this better than any taste I reckon you could get at the finest of restaurants. This place honestly is like paradise. Well, almost. It would be if not for the sandflies.
Yeah, got them. Feels a bit better too. Blue cod. Oh,
looks like a keeper off.
So the guys are back on the soft baits this morning, but I'm gonna try a micro jig, the Shimano Colt Sniper. And I'm gonna be fishing these on my light spin set with a Stradic 1000.
A bendy rod. See, just took the mean micro jig skills. Look, it's a real spotty one too.
Pretty one.
Yeah, there's a real pretty one.
Might be big enough to eat that one by the looks of them.
I told you we were going to get again at this spot.
Yeah, the micro jig. Beauty. Right, we're going to eat you, buddy. I know you're not the biggest gunner, but just for a taste comparison. It's only small, whatever it is. Oh, it's a little blue cotter jammer.
Another sharp top of the head. Oh, you've not got no experience with the G bangers.
No, I've never got one.
Tuck it under your wing.
What about you lifting with the rod? Oh.
Yep.
The slip was had a singing gullet.
No.
It looked like a bronze or something.
Tope.
Tope. It was a big tope. Yeah.
Hooka!
Hooka on 10 pounds.
We're on
7
down. Woo! Yeah. Woo! Yeah. Woo! Yeah. Nice scenic spot. Let's go do a bit of groper soft baiting.
Ring the bell.
Something. That is truly... I'll get to grab a photo if you don't mind, Sean. I want to before it... Could be a... I just don't know. A flathead. We're an Aussie. It's a flatty.
3 meter flatty.
Wow, that is buzzy.
Get in your gob, boy. The new style soft bait. This is going to look mint. It's going to munt his face a bit. But...
Here we go, boys.
Style soft bait.
Yep, blue banger. As predicted.
So it's soft bait.
I just caught that little fish on a, put it on a jig head and put it straight back down and caught a cod on it. See? Catching my own bait. Oops. The bait's reusable too. Go again.
So as soon as the boat stops anywhere, Shaw is out and he's fishing. And this time he's not soft baiting. He's doing some big game fishing. He's targeting the famous Fiordland mud marlin.
On the blue cod gear.
So this here is the Fiordland mud marlin, also known as a seven gill shark or seven giller. These prehistoric looking sharks have adapted perfectly for this environment, slinking along the bottom in the dark or murky water. And they've actually been responsible for quite a few attacks on humans. Not because they're aggressive, but because they're stupid. Their eyesight isn't the best, and because they're in dark and murky water, they will often just have a bit of a chew on something to figure out what it is, and sometimes it might be a person. And speak of the devil, here comes another one that's come up from the bottom to have a look at what all the commotion is about. It will have sensed this other shark thrashing around and it'll be thinking that there's a feed going on, that this is feeding activity. And here we go again. This is a shark that normally lives on the bottom, but now it's just looking for something to eat. And I've told Shaw that this might not be the best idea to rack these sharks up just before we go in for a dive.
I'll do a run now, you know.
I want to see you squealing. Do not lose that rod.
Mate, this thing can't pull me in.
Yeah, boy.
So for me, this is where the real magic in Fiordland is, under the water. We're just heading in for a free dive to get some power and some kina. The weather today is unreal. Fiordland is known for its wild weather and rain, loads of rain. So getting a day like today is a real treat. When you're looking for pala or abalone, if you want to find the areas they live, you've got to look for the right habitat. And there's three main things to look for. They need smooth rocks to be able to grip onto. It needs to be relatively shallow, as the algae that they eat needs sunlight to grow. So the murkier the water, typically the shallower they'll be. And it also helps if the area is exposed to swell, because the aerated water from the waves crashing into the shallows oxygenates the water and helps the algae growth. So there's hardly any swell today, so at the moment it's really easy to swim around here and just grab a few of these delicious power. It takes like literally minutes to grab half a dozen power, just enough to have a feed on the boat. And now it's Jude's turn. And there you go. Here's the first of our meritorious occasions. This is Jude's first parlor. So we've got enough parlor. Next up is one of my favorites, the kina or sea urchin. And down here, they are huge. So if you like kina, be prepared to be very jealous.
It's a monster. It's a monster. So you call it kina. Woo!
When I was down grabbing that kina, I spotted a crayfish. So Shaw slides down and grabs it. It's a perfect grab. Shaw's obviously done this before, up home with me, so he's made it look pretty easy. And the cray isn't damaged, so given we're not really after crays right now, we just let it go. But Jude, on the other hand, has never caught a crayfish before. So we decide to get him in on the action. And he lines up the next cray that we spot. So not to worry, it is normal to miss a crayfish. And fortunately, here, there's gonna be plenty more opportunities. And ironically, this next one we find has no feelers. It's probably lost them when it's been escaping the grab of a diver. So this crayfish actually has more experience with this than Jude, and boom, it's gone in a flash. But as I said, it is just normal to miss crayfish when you're learning, and the only way to get better is by doing it. So this time we get Jude on scuba. He's done his scuba's ticket and he's keen to get down there, and this will give him more time to take his time just to line up the crayfish and grab them. Okay, so here's our first customer, and I can just tell Jude is overthinking this. What you need to do here is go in hard with a committed deep lunge rather than a sort of in and out grab. The trick is not to think about pulling out, only think about reaching in and just keep reaching in. Because you can see what happened there, it was just a grab to where the cray was. What you need to do is allow for them to shoot back and really keep reaching in. But this is Fiordland, and there's gonna be loads more chances. And just around the corner, I find this nice easy one. Only I turn around and Jude has swum off in the opposite direction. So I'm just going in for a closer look here. And something to note too is the color of the water. This is from the tannins from all the rotting leaves in the surrounding bush and all the fresh water that sits on top of the salt water. And because of this, it's dark, so you get black coral in the shallows. That's this white stuff here. I mean, go figure, black coral, it's white. But anyway, it's among the longest living organisms on Earth. And normally you don't see it because it's hundreds of meters deep. Anyway, back to the crays. There's a heap of them here. So I'm just hanging out, marking the area until Jude finds his way back to me. And this big buck cray decides to come out and challenge me. And look at this stupid crustacean. You're just lucky I don't want to eat you right now. But anyway, right on cue, here comes Jude. And there's a few crays here to choose from. So I point out the easier one that can't get back too deep in the crack, and I roll the camera to capture the moment. And look at that, perfect grab. He's got it by the horns. But don't celebrate too soon, young fella. Get it in the catch bag. Now, I'm not quite sure if Jude was just expecting that this crayfish would go willingly into the catch bag and sit still, but he's about to find out how strong these crayfish really are. There we go, got him now. Nice work, Jude. And now he's got a feel for it, he's away, he'll be able to get them. I grabbed one for the bag too, mainly because I couldn't help myself, had to grab one. But the bit I've been waiting for is when we get back to the boat. This is what I really want to do. I want to find out if these kinna are fat. It's like a kinder surprise, or a kinna surprise. Just cracking one of these open to see what they're like inside. If you love kinna, you'll know what I'm talking about.
And if you shake them just the right amount of shake, you get rid of the guts but not the roe. See, guts comes out, the roe stick. And if you pass me one of those teaspoons there, grab that one. You scoop it up like so, and that's all yours, mate. Oh, 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 there you go.
Beautiful.
Beautiful?
Yeah.
Good man.
Absolutely beautiful. Best kinna I've ever had. Best uni. Well, I've only had it in sushi bars.
Yeah.
Okay, so, what do I need? Along the back, mate. Look, fill it over. Little cut. And tear. And see that? All of the bone stays behind on the skin. Boneless fillet right there. Simple as that. There's also a bit of a trick for cleaning up gurnard that we also have a step-by-step video for, but here I'm just showing my son Shaw how it's done.
What about your old dad? Oh, sorry.
And once again, look at this. We've got the most fresh produce to work with for dinner tonight. Not only do we have the fresh fish, but we've put the pawa through the mincer, and we've taken the meat out of the crayfish tail and minced that up too. So it's pawa fritters and crayfish fritters, or crayfish patties, as they call them down here. They don't like calling them fritters. I don't know what it's about, but call them what you like. This is a pretty unreal combo to be grazing on as we finish up our day. So today is the last full day of our trip, so we're going to head out of the fjords because the weather is perfect and we've got the opportunity to fish out here on the open coast, and we're still sticking with our lures only policy.
Here we are, fishing on the outside, on the wild west coast, which is not so wild today. And I've dropped down Baku Baku slow jig and I've hooked something. I've got no idea what it is. I'm hoping it's a trumpeter.
Oh, here it is. Blue cod. Trumpeter. Trumpy.
Trumpy.
Beautiful.
Trumpeter jammer. Just what I wanted. Another species.
Trumpeter.
Trumpy. Beautiful. We've got a fight out of it too.
Yeah, boy.
Yeah, now that. Oh no, Rob, you're kidding me! Oh no! That was your 3 kilo one.
You got 150 pound leader short, so you don't have to worry about lifting them in.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
There you go, boy.
That's not as big as Rob, but it's still a good one all the time. Chuck them in the bin, mate.
Hold on. Yeah, don't worry about
that. Put it this way, for the cod, it's a good one.
Yep. Blue cod. Ooh, yeah.
Beautiful, thank you.
That is a bulldog.
Another species.
So we've got a good haul of some of the tastier fish you will get anywhere. The tarakihi, blue cod, and trumpeter. And now we're on our way back in to get in the water again. It's our last dive for the trip, so this time we want to grab one crayfish for sashimi tonight and a few more to take home with us. So I've got Shaw and Jude to do the catching, and I've got the camera.
That's a real nice grab, bro.
That could be one for sashimi. Oh, it's Dean Alford,
man. Dean Alford, yeah. He's more here.
And once again, this cray is undamaged, and it's also a female, so we can afford to be selective. So Shaw just goes down and puts this girl back. But this one here is definitely not a female. It is way too big. It's a nice buck crayfish, so Shaw's got a chance to get what will easily be his biggest red crayfish. He's got it. Well, actually, I'm not sure. Maybe the cray's got him, because he's been dragged back into the crack. And now he's heading up empty-handed. Once the crays get right back in the crack, they're hard to get out. But don't worry, old dad just heads down and grabs them out, and this one is coming home with us. Right now, I'm literally breathing sandflies in through my snorkel. I reckon I've swallowed at least a dozen or more. Basically, anything here that's above the waterline just gets swarmed. But never mind a sandfly bite. A bite from one of these guys would be much worse. I've dropped my gun to help Shaw put the crayfish on the float, and this guy comes in for a look, of course, when I've got no gun in my hand. But the viz is good, so there's no real risk of one coming in and taking a bite at us, because we can all see what's going on. So we just carry on unbothered and keep getting our crayfish. So we've got a couple of crayfish each to take home with us now, but Shaw and Jude still want to get a trophy-sized buck cray. And after a bit of a hunt through some nice size crays, Shaw gets his hand on this guy here, and it's definitely big enough to be called a trophy. So we get a couple of picks. Jude also manages to get a nice big buck cray, and given that we've got enough crayfish to eat, both of the boys decide to let these big old crayfish go. And you can tell this big old crayfish here is not used to being in danger, because down here where there's no snapper, they have very few natural predators once they get big like this. But eventually he leaps off the side of the shelf, and we spend our final minutes in the water now just enjoying checking out the scenery and all of these crayfish. But while we're checking out the crayfish, there's something checking us out. Old mate Seven Giller has come back again, and it looks like he's just gonna cruise off after looking at us. And then he spots Shark Hunter Shaw and spins around and makes a beeline straight for Shaw. So I just give him a bit of a push to show him that we're not food. And moments later, another one comes in. And this one is bigger and missing a bit of its fin. So it too gets a bit of a nudge, just to let it know it should keep its distance. And I told you, Shaw, to leave those sharks alone. So you're lucky I don't let them get you. So the boys are a bit on edge with the sharks, then a seal comes ripping in. And I'm pretty sure I heard both of them squeal. But to be honest, it's actually a treat to see the seals and the sharks. And it's really good for the boys to have this experience with sharks, because when you dive, eventually you're going to encounter sharks, and the Seven Gillers are a nice mellow introduction. And yet they're another thing that we can remember and take away from this awesome trip. It always seems to be perfect weather like this when it's time to go home. But we've had a great couple of days in the wilderness of Fiordland, dining out on the best seafood you will get anywhere. And that's the end of my holiday. Time now to get back to work filming more fishing action and producing more content and how-to videos that you can watch for free right here at ultimatefishing.tv.